Hello and welcome to another edition of Elections Unlocked, where we are coming to you from Varanasi by the banks of the Ganga, where we've been tracking all that's happening on the election trail. But all the focus today was on 8 states and 49 seats that went to the polls today in the fifth round of the 2024 electoral battle. So we'll be focusing on those states where voting ended earlier this evening with a relatively moderate turnout. A lot of the focus has been on the state of Maharashtra, which finally completed its fifth and final round of polling. 13 constituencies out of the 49 that went to the polls were from Maharashtra, including the 6 Mumbai constituencies that have got a lot of attention. Remember, one reason why we are going to focus on Maharashtra today at the top of the show is many believe this is India's swing state of 2024. 48 seats on offer. Last time round, the BJP-led alliance won 41. But since then, much has changed. You've had the Shiv Sena and NCP both breaking away, both tying up with alternate alliances. You have the Mahayuti that's led by the BJP and the Mahavikas Agadi that's led on the other side by the Shiv Sena Uddhav Balasaheb Thackeray faction. So plenty has changed in Maharashtra, which is why there was so much of attention on the state this time that has finally completed its 5 rounds. Joining me now, 2 very special guests, Yashwant Deshmukh of Sea Voter, Sephologist, and someone who's tracking this poll very closely, and Sahil Joshi, our Mumbai editor, is also joining us. I appreciate both of you joining us. I want to come to you, Yashwant, first. We've been talking about Maharashtra for the last few months. Now that polling is over and it's been relatively moderate turnout in Maharashtra, not very high, can we get a sense of why Maharashtra is so tough to actually poll and understand this time?
Well, Rajdeep, first of all, it is difficult to understand simply because not a single equation whatsoever has remained intact. You know, politically speaking, Maharashtra has gone under tremendous political turmoil, and decades old equations have been defied, new equations form, and nobody knows what to make of it, number one. Number two, most importantly, I think the average Marathi voter felt so damn cheated right now that across the party line, all the parties they had voted for in the last 2 elections have actually dishonored, disrespected, insulted the mandate they gave. So the turnout has dropped significantly, and that drop in the turnout has resulted in a situation where probably every party is now scrapping to the bottom of the barrel to come out with their core votes, you know, those who will never defy the party and, you know, who would die rather than changing the party of sort. So eventually it might become a contest of core organizational strengths of sorts, and that too on different seats where they can mobilize their absolute core of the core voters to forget everything, forgive everything, and get down to the vote and get down to the polling station. Whomsoever is successful in that will have the last laugh.
Right. Sahil Joshi, you've been in and around Mumbai. You've been covering this election extensively. Explain this relatively low voter turnout. I know that Mumbai and Mumbaikars maybe took a long weekend, but still, if there is, as Yashwant says, a lot of anger against all that has happened, the political turmoil, strong alliances that are being forged, why was there not a higher voter turnout? Why? What explains? Are people of Maharashtra just fed up of politics? Why the relatively low voter turnout? I look at a Bengal, compare it with Maharashtra, there's almost a 20% difference in voter turnout.
Well, interestingly, this time what I think is that why the turnout is low is also because there are no exciting candidates, or the election did not excite them much as far as the Lok Sabha is concerned. If you look at the turnouts from 2009, since the time the delimitation has happened and there were realignment of the constituencies in Mumbai, you know, in 2009 it was almost 45%, and the highest turnout is 2019 when it was almost 54 to 55%. This time the voter turnout is going to be somewhere in middle, you know, somewhere the mark of 2014. So, you know, what I can come out of this is that this time both the fractions like Mahayuti and Mahavikas Agadi concentrated on their own pockets. Secondly, this time there was a floating voter in Mumbai. Nobody knew that where the Marathi voter is going to vote for. Till 2019, it was very clear that the Shiv Sena and the BJP alliance has its own pockets, strongly confined at various levels, and they knew exactly whom to take out and take to the polling center. But this time, even their workers were found it completely difficult to understand whether a particular voter, if I take him to the polling booth, is he going to vote for my party or is he the voter going to vote for the other party? Then there were many combinations. You know, the MNS workers were working for, for example, Rahul Shivale from South Central, against whom they had campaigned heavily in 2019. And now the same people are telling the voters from Shivaji Park that, okay, Rahul Shivale is a good candidate, please vote for him. So there was a lot of confusion among the voters as well. So the voters who have been voting for BJP since 2014 came out and voted. The voters who have been voting for Congress since 2014 have come out and voted. But the other voters who have been voting for Shiv Sena, they were confused whom to vote for, whether to listen to Raj Thackeray, whether to listen to Uddhav Thackeray, or to listen to Narendra Modi, whom they have been voting since 2014. So that's why this confusion could be seen. And most important part, I would like to reiterate, today it took me 1.5 hours to vote my vote in the morning. Yeah, Rajdeep. Mm-hmm.
You know, as you say, a lot of people had a lot of difficulties, you said, to come out and vote. And I think the Election Commission needs to look at why should it take so long. You said it took you 1.5 hours to actually come and cast your vote.
I just want to add one more point.
I want to understand from you, Yashwant Deshmukh. Yes, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
You know, I just want to add one more point. You know, this time the fight was very clear. You know, on one hand, there were people who had the whole administration in their hand. They were mighty with the money power. They were mighty with three big alliance partners, including MNS in Mumbai. And on the other hand, it was only Uddhav Thackeray because he did not have a support from Sharad Pawar, because Sharad Pawar has no influence in Mumbai at all. The Congress is in complete disarray in Mumbai. Their unit has not been able to perform since 2014. So it was one against four, that kind of fight we were seeing in Mumbai in 2024. And that's why on one hand, all the resources against, on the other hand, only the sympathy card, only the card where they could say, somehow you need to save the Shiv Sena, which is, the Shiv Sena in Mumbai and Shiv Sena outside Mumbai are two different parties.
Right.
So that's why the original regional party of Maharashtra needs to be saved. So whether it has worked in the Marathi voter is something which we would only come to know on 4th when the results will be out. This time the contest is going to be really thin. The margins are going to be really thin.
You know, I want to understand from you, Yashwant Deshmukh. I've been looking at Mumbai elections over the years, and often what Mumbai does, India does. At least in the last four elections, we've seen that. In 2004... five seats went to the UPA, one to the NDA, UPA forms a government. 2009, UPA wins all six, UPA forms a government. NDA wins all six, 2014 and 19, they form a government. Is Mumbai really a microcosm for the country? When you're looking for trends, Yashwant, as a pollster, would you say that what happens in Mumbai often determines the larger landscape?
Well, yes and no, Rajdeep, because all the seats of Mumbai have a different demographic flavor to it. So certainly there is an impact of sort when you look into different Lok Sabha seats of Mumbai from different perspectives. Some have the North Indian migrant voters a lot over there. Some have Gujarati and South Indian voters. And some are Khanti Mumbaikar seats, like Marathi seats. Now, the question is, if this Marathi seat has kind of gone beyond what we have seen so far, because there was no division of that kind of vote by and large, because Shiv Sena and the BJP have been contesting all along, barring that assembly election in 2014, they always contested together for many years. So there was no confusion whatsoever. But this time, particularly on the seats where it is Shinde Sena versus Uddhav Sena, that kind of thing is going to determine the baseline for the coming assembly election. And this is why it is very critical. And when I say baseline, this baseline is again not of the swing vote, Rajdeep. This is going to be a baseline of absolute core support base that these parties actually enjoy and where they can look out to build upon that after the Lok Sabha elections get over. But as on today, the results may only reflect the core support base. They may or may not reflect what this would look like as and when we approach the assembly elections, because then the larger mass of the voters, of the swing voters, will also join in. Right now, as we look into the turnout, it is a disappointing one. And this is why it is so difficult, Rajdeep, even to read it as a anti-incumbent or pro-incumbent of sorts. What is even worse, you mentioned West Bengal. I have been observing wherever the elections are really close, good, tough, tight contest across India, the turnout has been very significantly healthy. But this drop of turnout in Maharashtra is something which is so difficult to read right now, because it neither signifies anti or pro or status quo. It doesn't signify anything, to be honest.
Okay, let's leave it there then, Yashwant and Sahil. There's also, of course, the confusion over party symbols. When you are a Shiv Sena voter and you go to the polling booth, do you vote for the traditional bow and arrow or do you vote for the mashal of Uddhav Thackeray? So really, Mumbai was a test case today of the two major fronts in Maharashtra, and we look closely at that result, of course, on the 4th. Sahil Joshi and Yashwant Deshmukh, always a pleasure having you on the show. Thank you so much for joining me. Let's stay with Mumbai. And remember, when it's voting day, despite the fact that it was a Monday and some people may have taken a long weekend, Bollywood stars were out. The city of Bollywood stars, many of them went out and many of them urged the young to vote. Let's look at some of the glamour quotient on polling day in Mumbai.
It was a star-studded polling day in Mumbai. The Bollywood brigade, led by example in Maximum City, that usually does not show much enthusiasm when it comes out. Superstar Shah Rukh Khan stepped out to vote late afternoon. He had already posted on X asking citizens to carry out their duty and vote keeping the country's best interests in mind. Akshay Kumar, who exercised his right to vote for the first time after becoming an Indian citizen, was also upbeat.
मैं चाहता हूँ कि मेरा भारत जो है वो विकसित रहे, वो मजबूत रहे, पूरा भारत वोट करे जो उनके दिमाग में सही लगे.
Parents to be Ranveer Singh and Deepika Padukone turned up to vote, twinning in white. It was the first time that the world got a glimpse of Deepika's baby bump too. Aamir Khan, Kiran Rao, Hrithik Roshan and family also voted in Mumbai.
हर एक इंसान बाहर आए और अपना वोट कास्ट करे, ये और हमारे इस विशाल लोकतंत्र का हिस्सा बने इसका प्रोसेस करे.
Study the candidates before you vote. Know what you're voting for.
Janhvi Kapoor was one of the early birds at her polling booth. Dressed in a fuchsia pink Indian ensemble, she was seen donning a customized dupatta, which was an ode to the latest song from her upcoming film, Mr. and Mrs. Mahi. While Janhvi arrived solo, her younger sister Khushi was accompanied by their dad Boni Kapoor as they voted for their preferred candidate. Hema Malini with daughter Isha, veteran actor Dharmendra, his son Sunny Deol were there to vote too.
We have done maximum publicity for people to come and vote.
एक-एक वोट मायने रखता है और आपका हक है तो जरूर आज का दिन निकल के आके वोट कीजिए.
This is the one right that you've been given to express what it is that you feel, what kind of government you want, what kind of governance you'd like. So I urge all your viewers to please make the effort and vote.
मैं अपील करता हूँ कि यार सब लोग आओ. वोट कीजिए आप लोग, सब आना चाहिए जैसे मैंने किया. ये देखो
खुशी का दिन है आज और हम सब नागरिकों को, हिंदुस्तान के नागरिकों को जाना चाहिए और वोट करना चाहिए, और इसलिए मैं वोट कर रही हूँ.
Bollywood's Young Brigade was out in full force. Ananya Pandey, Kiara Advani, Sania Malhotra, Ishan Khattar and Ira and Junaid Khan exercised their right to vote. Others who also lined up in Mumbai were Rekha, Sunil Shetty, Vidya Balan and cricketer Sachin Tendulkar.
Problems do wajah se hote hai. Ek is you act without thinking or you just keep thinking aur act nahi karte. मैं आज सभी को यही दरख्वास्त करता हूं कि प्लीज आइए और अपना वोट कास्ट कीजिए.
Several celebrities also took to their social media to share their pictures as they participated in democracy's biggest festival. High profile participation in a high stakes battle. The celebs have voted, as has the janta, to decide Mumbai ka king kaun. Entertainment Bureau, India Today.
You are with Elections Unlocked. On this big voting day, I want to turn to Jammu and Kashmir's Baramulla in North Kashmir. We witnessed a slice of history because this is a notoriously low turnout constituency, but the voter turnout was close to 55% by 5 p.m. In Ladakh, which also voted, the turnout was even higher at 67%. The fact that parts of Jammu and Kashmir are voting strongly this time, many believe, is a hopeful sign in a state that is supposed to hold assembly polls later this year. Our other special report from Mir Farid, he tells us what happened in Baramulla today.
Baramulla in North Kashmir voted enthusiastically in the fifth phase of Lok Sabha elections. This is the first election in Baramulla since the abrogation of Article 370.
हम इस उम्मीद में आए यहाँ पर अभी आज हम एक रिप्रेजेंट चूज करें जो बेटर फ्यूचर के लिए चाहे हमारी एजुकेशन के बारे में हो चाहे हमारे कश्मीर के बारे में हो चाहे हमारी जो अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट वो बहुत ज़्यादा है कश्मीर में
हमें पहली बार ये मौका मिल रहा है यहाँ वोट डालने का जो हमें बंधक बनाया गया था जो हमें हक था उससे हम अभी तक कोसों दूर था 10 साल हुए अभी तक इलेक्शन नहीं हुए हम इंतजार कर रहे थे इस मौके को
Former Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister and National Conference Leader Omar Abdullah and Jammu and Kashmir People's Conference Chief Sajjad Lon are the main contenders for the seat. Independent candidate Abdul Rashid Sheikh, popularly known as Engineer Rashid, is also contesting from Baramulla, while in jail. PDP's Fayaz Ahmed Mir is also in the fray.
रिपोर्ट्स बड़ी अच्छी आ रही है लोग भारी तादाद में अपने वोट का इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं और यही हमें से उम्मीद है और एक उम्मीदवार होने के नाते मेरी ये उम्मीद है कि ज्यादा से ज्यादा वोट जो है नेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस और मुझे मिले
Baramulla broke all previous records of voting as today it registered 57% polling. And according to the Chief Election Officer, Jammu Kashmir, this number is all set to increase as final figures of voting are yet to come. Since early morning today, voters came out in huge numbers, enthusiastically participating in the Festival of Democracy. Interestingly, if you talk of 2019 elections, Baramulla only registered 34% polling. So this time around, the voter turnout has increased by more than 24%.
EC had set up 21 booths in Jammu, 4 booths in Delhi and a booth in Udhampur for over 27,000 displaced Kashmiri pundits. With Mir Farid in Baramulla, Bureau Report, India Today.
Okay, that's all that we could pack in on Elections Unlocked. Thanks very much for watching. News and updates continue on India Today. Namaskar.